and dwell with the shepherd of the hills on this, the third Sunday of Advent. As the church year was being developed, Advent was a very early addition to the church year. The four Sundays before Christmas were a time of repentance, as we reflect upon the words of the prophet, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near." The church fathers also wanted us to make sure that as we repent, it is done out of sorrow, but we don't not remain in our sorrow, because repentance leads to joy, because Christ has revealed to us that he has come to pay for our sins and has removed the guilt from our lives and has given us an eternal joy. And so the third Sunday of Advent was set apart as a Sunday of joy to reflect upon all the blessings that God has given us through his Son, Jesus Christ. And so that's what we're focused on today. Our opening hymn is hymn number 11, "Comfort, Comfort All My People." May God bless you.
Thank you.
look, Christ is coming with the clouds.
Every eye will see him, even those who pierced him.
Lest that day surprise us unprepared, let us make confession of our sins and point our Heavenly Father to have mercy on us for the sake of Jesus Christ. Came to call us from darkness into light. Lord, have mercy.
Thank you. dismiss of Hosanna accompanied by the giant choir.
Thank you.
Please stand. Our gospel lesson is John chapter 1, verses 6 through 8, and then 19 through 28. You should never forget where our joy comes from. It comes from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself up for you and for me. We read from our gospel. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify about the light, so that everyone would believe through him. He was not the light, but he came to testify about the light. This is the testimony John gave when the Jews from Jerusalem sent priests and Levites to ask him, "Who are you?" He confessed and did not deny. He confessed, "I am not the Christ." And they asked him, "Who are you then? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" "No," he answered. Then they asked him, "Who are you? Tell us so we can give an answer to those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" He said, "I am the voice of the one crying out in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' just as Isaiah the prophet said." They had been sent from the Pharisees, so they asked John, "Why then do you baptize if you are not the Christ or Elijah or the prophet?" "I baptize with water," John answered. "Among you stands one you do not know. He is the one coming after me, whose sandal strap I am not worthy to untie." These things happened in Bethany beyond the Jordan, where John was baptizing. This is the gospel of our Lord. Praise be to you, O Lord Christ. Please be seated as we sing our sermon. Testament lesson. I want to reread that first verse again. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to preach good news to the afflicted. He sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives, and release for those who are bound. Dear brothers and sisters, in one sentence, or maybe just in a couple of words, tell me, what is the Bible's main message? Now, if I asked here that question here, individually, to everyone here, I would probably get quite a few different answers. Not because we don't agree on what the Bible's main message is, but because there are a lot of ways to express it. Jesus loves me. This I know. Jesus died for me on the cross. Jesus forgives my sins. Jesus saves me. He reconciles me to God. He renews me. He makes me his child. Jesus promises me an inheritance of heaven. Jesus has made us holy, declared us righteous. He has redeemed me. He has defeated sin, death, and the devil. He rescues me. He restores me. And on that list could go. Well, it's sometimes a challenge for a pastor to express the truth of the gospel in a fresh way and not repeat himself over and over and over again. In reality, there are a lot of ways to say that Jesus died for me. Just ask Isaiah. In today's reading, a messianic prophecy overflows with a multitude of expressions, all telling the same good news that Christ brings. Kind of reminds me of a story I once heard, you've probably heard before too. A young child was feverishly drawing a picture. And breaking his concentration, his mom asked him, "What are you drawing?" "I'm drawing God," the child said. To which his mother inquired, "But nobody knows what God looks like." Well, that didn't stop the boy, who simply said, "They will when I'm done with it." Isaiah, in a sense, is painting a picture for us today of what it will look like when the Messiah comes. He was looking forward to that day. We look back both at the Christ who has come, and we look forward to the Christ coming again. Either way, when Christ comes, things look different. Jesus turns everything upside down in a listing of opposites in our Old Testament lesson. He says, "It is not like this, but it is like this instead." Isaiah says, "In our sin, we are all of these things and more. We are poor. We are brokenhearted. We are captives. We are bound. We are mourners. We are filthy with ashes. We are faint of spirit. But in our Savior, Jesus, we are rich. We are healed. We are free. We are comforted. We are cleansed. We are beautiful. We are full of praise to our God." The good news he brings is always the answer to the problems that we are facing. Are you worn down? Are you broken down by this life? Christ has come to mend you. Are you filthy in sin? Christ cleanses you. Are you mourning? He brings you comfort. Are you a captive? Christ has made you free. Jesus has some good news for us. And it's good news which actually applies to us and to our problems. It's good news that's real and meaningful and powerful. He comes to turn our sinful world upside down. At Christmas, we celebrate the incarnation of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Jesus, true God, took on flesh and came to our earth to do what we could not do. He lived the perfect life in our place, even though he was surrounded by sin. And what was the mission of Jesus? Isaiah tells us, "The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to preach good news to the afflicted." Well, who's the afflicted that Jesus is preaching to? He's talking about you and me. What's our affliction? We're afflicted by sin and death. You and I were captives to sin.
sin, bound by death. On our own, we stand before God, weighed down by the chains of sin and death. Our sin drags us down to hell because God says that He cannot stand sin. He hates it. And how many times have you and I sinned before God? That count is certainly innumerable. The weight of that is insurmountable on our shoulders as we just can't bear our own sin. So what are you going to do about it? The truth is, there's nothing you can do. You can't just shake off the chains of sin. You can't just ignore death because it comes for all of us. We know that. God knows that too. While He can't even stand the thought of sin, He also couldn't stand the thought that you wouldn't be with Him in heaven one day. So He sent His Son. It was on the cross that Jesus became our vicarious atonement. He took upon Himself your chains. He suffered the pangs of death so that you wouldn't have to. In fact, instead of death, which we rightly deserve, God gives to us now life. Through baptism, Paul says that we are connected to His death, but also to His resurrection, and that because Christ lives, you too shall live. You don't have to fear death and hell anymore, because Christ has removed your guilt from you. He has healed you. He has bound your wounds. He has freed you. Jesus has risen from the dead, and He has given you the crown of victory. He has crowned you on your head with His glory and has declared to you that you are not guilty. Now God our Father calls you His own dear child. And the Holy Spirit has created the fire of faith in your heart. Why is Christmas such a wonderful time of the year? Isn't that because I have another opportunity to praise my God and my Savior? That during Christmas season, we have this beautiful picture drawn for us by our holy God as He gifts to us His own dear Son to be our Savior. Now from our gospel lesson, we know that John the Baptist had a part in painting this picture for us. John's news was that someone was going to come after him with even better news. But did you know that in Luke chapter 7, John had his moments of doubt? Thrown in prison for speaking up against King Herod, John sent some of his disciples to Jesus and asked Jesus if He was really the one who was to come. And better than simply giving John a yes or a no answer, Jesus says this: "Go back and report to John what you have seen and heard. The blind receive sight, the lame walk. Those who have leprosy are cured. The deaf hear, the dead are raised. And the good news is preached to the poor." Jesus reverses all of these conditions: blindness, deafness, lameness, leprosy, and even death itself. But the real kicker, the most important part, is the last one: that the good news, the gospel, is preached to the poor. It's as if John is pointing, or it's Jesus is pointing John and us back to our Old Testament lesson, back to Isaiah 61, to show that yes, He has fulfilled the promises. He delivers the goods. He brings the good news. But in Isaiah chapter 61 here, we actually see two more ways in which that painting is drawn for us. We're told that we are dressed for the occasion. Now, with Christmas in mind, perhaps you have a special outfit already picked out for Christmas Day or for Christmas Eve, or if you're like me, you have that tie that you wear only on Christmas. We often dress up for special occasions, and perhaps no life event is more formal than a wedding. Isaiah picks up on that image, that when the Lord comes, it's going to be like a great wedding feast, a day which is long awaited for, a day which is a great celebration, a day which is the high point of the year, maybe even the high point of someone's life.
So we dress appropriately for that.
But what if you have nothing to wear under this weather?
That's actually how we all are. We all look in the closet of our heart and find that the laws of sin have destroyed our garments. We have nothing to wear on our own, except, as Isaiah puts it, a faint spirit or a spirit of despair. We're all like our first parents, Adam and Eve, shamefully hiding our sins from the Lord. The best that they could do was sew together some fig leaves, a makeshift covering at best. When God comes to the garden, he's well aware of their sin. But instead of shaming them further, he provides for them. He gives them the gospel promise in Genesis 3:15. And then also in mercy, as he escorts them out of the Garden of Eden. Did you know that God made them proper clothing made out of the skins of animals? As Adam and Eve are dressed by the Lord, we too must be dressed by God. But for us, there isn't a dead animal or a fur coat that we can put on to cover our sin. Instead, though, God sacrifices his own son so that now you and I are clothed with Christ. As Revelation 7 says, those in heaven have washed their robes in the blood of the Lamb. Or as Isaiah says here, that we have been clothed with garments of salvation, clothed, God has clothed me in robes of righteousness. That's what things look like when the Messiah comes. That's how God dresses us in Christ. That is the good news. And then Isaiah gives us one final image. He moves on to agriculture. Twice Isaiah refers to this planting. And here too, we see a great change, a great reversing. He's preaching to us the good news. From the tiny acorn comes a mighty oak tree, one of nature's great contrasts. Like a faith the size of a mustard seed, to use another parable, which grows into this large bush. When God begins, he seems to start out small and insignificant, but before you know it, big things are happening. Our faith is like that. Our faith begins with a few words of scripture, God's promises in his name, and a little water. And this small thing that we call baptism is actually very powerful. It has the power to save. Because it's God's gospel, and it's God's call. God starts small, and ends big. Not too unlike the humble babe in a manger, who as a man dies a shameful death on a cross, but by doing so, pays for the sins of the world. God takes the small, the humble, the lowly, and he works wonders. And of course, as always, it's God who is doing the doing. Just as he sends the messenger with the good news, just as he takes that spirit of despair and clothes us with the garment of praise, so too the righteousness he brings to us and for us, he plants, he waters, he makes it grow. We simply receive the blessings. So today, once again, we hear the good news, the gospel of Jesus. Whether it's about new clothes or an impressive garden or a little baby in a manger, it's the same good news we hear every week. Just in a slightly different way. Because Christ always brings the good news to the poor. Isaiah's poetic prophecy makes it clear. The good news of Jesus brings rejoicing where there was once despair. So let us rejoice. And let us take delight in our Savior. Amen. May the peace of God, which transcends understanding, guard your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. Please stand, and let's confess our faith together using the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made.
buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Please be seated. As we gather our name offerings, I would ask that you also please sign our friendship registers, which are located at the end of each pew.
Use your mighty word to shatter our pride and to rouse us from spiritual slumber and apathy.
Move us to change our heart for the words of John. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is here.
You sent your Son to redeem us from sin. Let this good news be our joy and strength. Use it to cheer the lonely, encourage the fearful, and give hope to the despairing. In these days before Christmas, spare us from the stress of deadlines and the frenzy of commercialism.
Fill our lives with the message of your peace and the music of your grace.
Direct our eyes not only to the manger, but also to the skies, where we will see your Son coming again, not as a lowly child, but as the Lord of Lords.
Lift up our hearts in joyful anticipation of that day.
Lord, as we pray for those who are near and dear to us, we ask that you would be with Larry Gunthorpe, who is still currently hospitalized, with Sue Spencer, sister of Mary Golder, and Robert Andrews Jr., who are recovering from surgery. And also, we would ask that you would bring comfort to the family and friends of Walter Rowe, who is the father of Rosalind Rowe and the grandfather of Jennifer Redland. Walter passed away yesterday. We ask, Lord, that you would bring to us the joy of your resurrection and hold you to the faithfulness that you have promised to us, that you will never leave us, nor will you ever forsake us. And hear us, Lord, as we bring you our private petitions. Gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you. This is the true Bible.
Help me to strengthen and preserve you in the true faith until life everlasting. Depart in peace, your sins are forgiven. Take and drink. This is the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, poured out for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Take and drink. This is the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, poured out for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Now may to strengthen and preserve you in the true faith until life everlasting. Depart in peace. Your sins are forgiven. Take and drink. This is the true love of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, poured out for you.
Hear the prayer of your people.
lips which have praised you here may glorify you in the world, that the eyes which have seen the coming of your Son may long for his coming again. And that all who have received in his true body and blood the pledge of your forgiveness may be restored to live a new and holy life through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Brothers and sisters, go in peace. Live in harmony with one another. Share the gospel and serve the Lord who blesses. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace.
As Pastor said, I'm here on behalf of our stewardship committee. Our stewardship committee committee watches our congregation and tries to lead us for spiritual giving of our money and also of our time. After the first of the year, we have been busy. I know you don't hear from us a lot, but we have been busy doing things. After the first of the year, we're going to introduce a new program for giving to help not only finance what we're doing now, but finance our new building. We'll have more on that after the first of the year. Today, I'm here to talk to you about service and about volunteering and doing things. I know from my life that it's made a huge difference in my life. Actually, it's changed my whole life. Volunteering, being available when somebody comes to you. A couple weeks ago, we had a Bible class out of campus ministry, and it was on Moses and God coming to him in the burning bush. And I thought at that time, I thought, wow, how amazing if God would do that. Just come right to us and tell us, hey, this is what I want you to do. This is where I want you to go. He doesn't do that very often. He does come to us, though, in different ways. Usually it's through somebody in the stewardship committee or maybe the pastor that comes to you and says, hey, we have had an opportunity for you to go here and do this. Many times when that happens to us, we're just like Moses, and we say right away, I can't do that. I don't have the skills to do that. I'm too busy. I've got other things to do. That's the wrong answer. God told Moses, and he tells us too, he's going to give us the strength. He's going to give us the knowledge. He's going to show us how to do things. He's going to lead us. He will do that stuff for us, and he does. He still does that today. I know that from my own. So what I'm here to do today to do is to tell you of some opportunities that we have for you. We're going to try to come to you every couple of months or so and give you more opportunities. Right now we're in dire need of some people to visit shut-ins. Fairly easy thing to do. You just have to go whenever it's available for you and visit some people that are shut in and can't come here. I'm sure probably there's some people that you might know that are shut-ins that can't come here that you might enjoy visiting with. We also need some ushers for, I think, both services here at Shepherd of the Hills. Again, something fairly easy to do. You have to show up a little half hour before church, but somebody will walk you through it, and after a while, you'll be ready to go. It's a good service opportunity. Also, I know Amy. Also, we have some opportunities out of campus ministry right now. God's blessed us here in the last few weeks with three new families out there with seven children and six adults that have been coming to church, coming to Bible classes, even attending a Bible discovery class with Pastor Ackerman. I'm going to go to Korea here for a couple months again in January and February, and I, as you know, I teach some English. I don't teach English classes. I do English conversation. I sit at a table and talk to people, mostly from Korea. And I need somebody that will, several people maybe, that will volunteer 1 hour a week to go out and sit at a table with some international people, both youth and adults, to just guide them, actually make them have a good time here in the United States, just talk to people. The people that are out there now are very friendly people. They like to talk. They like to meet new people. So if you think you might have some kind of interest in that, and it would be good for you because I can tell you that it can be life-changing, come and see me, and I will try to set up a time with you so that you can get out there and meet me. Thank you. Good evening.